The human body is incredibly resilient. It can withstand impacts that would dent steel, and will continually try to find ways to survive and heal even when subjected to huge physical trauma and extreme pressure. What happens when you push that resilience to the outer limit, though? What happens when you expose your body to the raw power of a 46G force? To answer that question, we must first understand what we mean when we say G. G stands for gravitational constant, as defined by the work of Isaac Newton. He's the British physicist best known for discovering gravity when he was sat beneath a tree, and an apple fell on his head. Newton's work defines 1G as the gravitational force required to keep your feet on the ground. Without gravity, we'd all float away into space. A little gravity is a good thing, but when the effect of gravity is multiplied, it goes from being our friend to our worst enemy. 2Gs would be double the force required to keep us secured to the Earth. If we're walking around in 2G, we'd begin to feel a little heavy, but not so much that it would have a serious impact on our ability to go about our lives. When that goes up to 5G, things change. At 5G, you would feel like you were being crushed by 5 times your own body weight. Moving would be difficult, and so would breathing. Move the needle up to 10G and you're in serious trouble. Now you'd feel like an elephant was sitting on your chest like a dead weight, and your skin is trying to pull back away from your face. To give you an idea of context, hitting 100 miles per hour in a fast car would only expose you to around 1.2 Gs, barely enough to feel any difference at all. A Formula One driver going at 200 miles per hour or more is experiencing more like 4.5 Gs. That's one of the reasons they have to wear so much protective clothing and helmets. The human body simply isn't designed to withstand massive gravitational forces. Even the strongest and fittest of us eventually reach a point where survival becomes impossible. So, how is it possible that U.S. Air Force pilot Colonel John Stapp subjected himself to a force of 46 Gs and lived to tell the tale? We'll explain how in just a moment, but first, let us paint the full picture. Picture yourself as an astronaut, preparing to be launched into outer space. The rockets fire, propulsion builds up, and before you get a chance to scream, you're lifted away into the sky at incredible speed. G-force kicks in, and you're stuck fast to your seat, unable even to move your arms away from your chest. Not even your blood can properly withstand the force. It's pushed to the extremities of your body and pinned there, usually in your hands or your feet. Without blood flowing to your brain, you'll quickly succumb to a condition called cerebral hypoxia. In layman's terms, that's a shortage of oxygen in your brain. Strangely, this can make you feel happy and high, but that effect doesn't last for long. You're slowly losing consciousness. The blood vessels in your eyes begin to fail, first turning your vision black and white, and then completely blind. Seconds later, you'll be unconscious. This is known as a G-lock. You've been literally knocked out by gravitational force. Fortunately, in a space rocket, the extreme forces fade and come to an end before the worst of these effects kick in. If they didn't, trying to go into space would be a death sentence. The principles behind a G-lock have been used to design a hypothetical roller coaster, which would be the ultimate thrill ride, and by ultimate, we mean final. Designed by Lithuanian physicist and artist Julie Jonas Urbonas, the euthanasia coaster would be used either as a tool of execution or a method of departure for those wanting to end their own lives. There are 24 seats on this roller coaster, and by the end of the ride, everybody in those seats will be dead. Urbonas believes that his creation would be a humane way of executing people because the euphoric effect of oxygen starvation to the brain before death would make the process easy and painless. The ride would slowly work its way up to a peak 1,600 feet in the air, offer its passengers one last chance to get off, and then plunge down a sheer drop, with riders experiencing 10 Gs of pressure. You can survive 10 Gs for approximately 1 minute before the effects become terminal, so a series of tight, fast loops would keep the pressure up for long enough for the coaster to do its job before delivering its payload of deceased passengers back to the start. The euthanasia coaster is just an idea, for now. But would it be a more humane way for people to die than a lethal injection? Let us know your thoughts down in the comments. We just told you that experiencing a 10G force for one full minute would kill you. But earlier on, we said that John Stapp hit 46 Gs and survived. Now it's time to tell you his incredible tale. The story begins after the Second World War, just as the beginning of the Cold War began to take hold. The United States of America was battling against Russia for supremacy in military force, technological capability, and economic power. Desperate times called for desperate measures, and it's within those desperate measures that seemingly miraculous events can occur. The Second World War had demonstrated that planes were now just as important as land forces when it came to combat, if not more important in some cases. Both sides believed that having the best air force would give them the edge in the event that a full-scale war broke out, and so they pushed their designers and their pilots to the limits of endurance and beyond. Beyond that, there was also a symbolic power struggle, the race to put a human being on the surface of the moon. Back in the 1940s, the idea of a lunar landing was more of a dream than a scientific possibility. But it didn't stop either side from trying to develop technology capable of the job. Space rockets didn't just appear from nowhere. They were the result of years of innovative and dangerous research. Of all the people available to the United States at the time, John Stapp was uniquely qualified. He'd served in the US Air Force, but he also had an exceptional mind. Stapp was a doctor, a surgeon, and a physicist. It's probably fair to say that he was a genius, and also a little crazy. Stapp wanted to make planes safer for his fellow pilots after personally witnessing several plane crashes during the war. Some of his friends survived those crashes, and some of them didn't. Stapp was sure that there must be more to surviving than pure luck, and he was determined to find out what that something might be. To that end, he put himself forward to participate in experiments that would have made any normal person run away in terror. As an example, he decided to find out what happens if a military plane's canopy explodes during a flight by taking a fighter jet into the air with no windshield or protection, and flew it at 570 miles an hour in a straight line. It hurt, but it didn't kill him, so he pushed himself further. The US Navy knew that they had a man who'd do anything for the cause, and so they commissioned him to undertake top-secret research into the effects of extreme gravitational forces on the body. At first, the goal of the research was to boost the survival rate of their pilots in plane crashes, but Stapp's work became invaluable in designing space rockets years later. The work began on the ground. Volunteers were strapped to rocket-propelled sleds and then fired across specially designed tracks in the desert, before the brakes were slammed on sharply. The resultant gravitational force was roughly equivalent to smashing headlong into a wall at more than 100 miles per hour. Many volunteers suffered severe injuries. Some of them didn't survive at all. Because he was conscious of not asking people to do things he wouldn't do himself, Stapp personally participated as a test subject in every single experiment. The early results enabled him to make small recommendations about how to position a seat, and the best place to fit a harness. But Stapp wasn't enthused by these little adjustments. He felt like there was much more to discover, and if no volunteers could be found, he decided he'd do it all himself. Against the orders of his superiors, Stapp carried on undertaking testing in secret, increasing the acceleration and top speed before he slammed the brakes on each time. His fastest rocket sleds shot across the desert at over 300 miles per hour. Stapp broke his ribs and then broke his wrists. When those injuries healed, he put himself straight back in danger and subjected himself to such severe force that the fillings were stripped away from his teeth. Still, he wasn't satisfied. He knew that fighter jets flew faster than his rocket sled, and until he could match those speeds and replicate the effects, he wasn't going to stop. Knowing full well that it might be the last thing he ever did, Stapp designed and built a sled called Sonic Wind 1, capable of exceeding 400 miles per hour. On the morning of December 10th in 1954, Stapp said his goodbyes to his loved ones, knowing full well that he may never see them again, and strapped himself aboard Sonic Wind 1. The purpose of this final test was to simulate the force that a human body would experience if suddenly ejected from a plane at supersonic speed. Nobody knew the answer to that question, because nobody had ever survived such an incident. All Stapp had was a crash helmet to protect him, which likely offered no real protection whatsoever. The rocket roared into life in the desert of New Mexico, and Stapp blasted across the track almost faster than the eye could see. The G-force crushed him against his uncomfortable seat, as the blood was driven back from his brain, and his vision began to fade. As Sonic Wind 1 hit a peak speed of 632 miles per hour, Stapp became the fastest man who'd ever lived. Now, the wind whipping across his battered body was the equivalent of a pilot ejected into the air from a jet flying at 1,000 miles per hour. Stapp was in totally uncharted territory and extreme danger. The acceleration was almost lethal. The sudden stop would prove to be even worse. Stapp's brand new and barely tested liquid braking system kicked into life at the end of the track, subjecting Stapp to deceleration forces that ought to have killed him. The harness strained under the pressure. The air was brutally forced out of his lungs and they collapsed. His internal organs were pushed together and his eyes bulged inside his skull. Stapp had gone from a near supersonic speed to a complete stop in less than a second. And in the process, he'd experienced 46 G's of pressure against his body. As his team of medics approached, expecting to have to carry his body away from the rocket, they were astonished to find him alive. Stapp's skin had blistered, and his eyes were bleeding. He was blind, and he could barely talk. Somehow, despite his grim appearance, Stapp had experienced a miracle. Every blood vessel in his eyes had burst, but the retinas didn't detach. Within hours, his sight returned. The next morning, he was wide awake in the hospital with no permanent injuries. He was sore, but he hadn't broken a single bone. Stapp had dueled with death to prove that with the right combination of harness, positioning, and protection, extreme G-force was survivable. He'd won his battle. Thanks to Stapp, ejector seats were developed that could protect their occupant and save their life, even if they were forced to bail out at hundreds of miles per hour. John Stapp eventually retired from the military and went to work on automobiles, helping scientists and researchers to develop safe cars that crumpled to protect their drivers during crashes. He also helped to design and build crash test dummies, so nobody else would ever have to go through what he'd experienced. Thanks to him, it had been proven that humans could both move faster and survive greater pressures than previously thought possible. And the dream of sending a rocket into space with a human on board was a step closer to reality. He was called the bravest man in the world by his commanding officers. He was definitely that, and definitely a little bit out of his mind, too. But we should salute him as one of the most remarkable men who ever lived. Subscribe to the channel and turn on notifications, and you will be the first to know when a new video comes out. Thank you for watching, and see you soon.